We're going to be in Acts, looking at Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 3 this morning. This is the start of the third section of Acts, where we really get to focus on the spreading of the gospel throughout the Roman world at the time, where Paul really gets going and goes on his second and third mission trips, ultimately ending up in front of Caesar. The Great Commission in Acts 1, chapter 1, verse 8, says, "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Well, we've seen the witness in Jerusalem from Acts 1 through Acts 8. Starting in Acts 8, we kind of see the spreading through Judea and Samaria with, you know, Peter and Philip. And then starting here in chapter 13, the focus turns and it goes to Paul and his journeys throughout the world to bring the news to the Gentiles. Today is Senior Sunday, and in much the same way, I've always thought of the Great Commission as kind of three levels. The first level, Jerusalem, being wherever you are. For our graduating seniors, it has been high school. That has been their mission field. It was one of the greatest mission fields they will probably ever know. For 4 years, it dominated their lives. They spent more time in school than they did anywhere else. They spent more time with their teachers than they did their parents. Then we have Judea and Samaria, which to me represents your state, your country, the people that you are familiar with. Finally, you have the world, the people that you are not familiar with. This is what we are sending the seniors out into. High school, Nederland, Port Neches, this area is very, very familiar. 2005, I spent the summer in Mecklenburg County, Virginia, working with Concord Baptist Association and a local camp there, doing vacation Bible schools, camps, things like that. And it was a fantastic time. But whenever I came home, there really was this feeling of familiarity, of home. Our seniors are about to lose that, in a way. College is completely different than high school. I remember the first day of college, I was walking through the quad at Lamar, and there was a guy coming to me, his name was Kevin Miller. I'd known Kevin Miller since fifth grade. I had been to school with him for years. He walks up to me, and he's smoking a cigarette. On campus, in front of everyone. I'm sorry, what? This is like 3 months removed from high school graduation. You're not supposed to be doing it. You can do that? Really? Okay. Things change as they leave, as our seniors leave high school and they move on into college. Perhaps it is fitting that we start, that starts their trip to the world in Antioch. If we flip back to chapter 11, we have the first description of the church in Antioch. This is the first church that we really get to see besides Jerusalem, where it's really described as who these people are. After the death of Stephen, the persecution of the Christians meant that they had to leave Jerusalem. A lot of them had to flee, basically. And in that flight, they found new churches wherever they landed. One of the places that they landed was Antioch. It was founded by people from Cyprus and Cyrene by way of Jerusalem. It is where they were first called Christian, and it is where the Word of God, the message of Jesus, the message of Christ as the Messiah, was really first preached to non-Jews in Antioch. Before this, Christianity was called the Way, and it was basically a sect of the Jewish faith. They followed all the Jewish rules. They kept the Sabbath. They did everything that they were supposed to do. As good Jews, they just believed that Christ was the Messiah sent to save their people. Here, in chapter 11, verse 20. It says, some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks also. These were people that did not have that ground, that base of belief. See, it was not easy, but easier to convince a Jew that Jesus was the Messiah. You could pull out Isaiah and show him in the scrolls, as Philip did with the Ethiopian, that, you know, this is who, you know, Isaiah is talking about. He is talking about Jesus. You know, he did these things. He was born in Nazareth. He was of the tribe of David. You know, all these things match up. Greeks did not have that. Greeks had Zeus and Hermes and Hera and a pantheon of gods that I could not begin to describe. So they did not have these things. This is where the church first kind of starts to step outside of what it knows, of where it's at. A few things, though, that I want us to look at in this as we read, starting in verse 1 of chapter 13. It says, now in the church of Antioch, these were prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. A few things that I want us to look at, and I want our graduating teachers to really take note of in these scriptures. The first thing, I want you to look at the makeup of the church. There's some question now these days about what makes a Christian. You know, is it that we have to look a certain way, act a certain way? Can he drink? Can he have tattoos? Can he, you know, how is he supposed to look? How is he supposed to act? Is there such a thing as a homosexual Christian? And all of this, what gets lost is the important part. Does he follow Christ? I said earlier that Christians were first called Christians in Antioch. It literally means Christ's life. All this other stuff, how you worship, how you pray, whether or not you do the sign of the cross, whether or not you get on your knees, whether or not you raise your hands, whether or not you can dance in your service, whether or not you know, you think you can have tattoos or not. All of that is secondary. It's denominational. It is not as important as, do you follow Christ? Do you believe what he said? Do you live out how he wants us to live? Look at the makeup of this church. There were two North Africans. Manaen, who was brought up with royalty. Saul, who was considered the preeminent star of the Pharisees' religious party. And Barnabas, who was basically a leader of the church. I mean, that's a pretty... These are the people who led the church of Antioch. That's a pretty... You know, the diverse group of people. They could have this diversity, they could maintain this diversity because each of them understood what was important. What is important is, do we follow Christ? Do we claim him as our Messiah? Is he the center of our lives, as we were saying earlier? Once we have that base established, everything else is personal preference. What, you know, I'm a big fan of, I'll call it moving about in worship, because it's not really dancing, because I can't dance. I'll call it moving to the rhythm. It's how I worship. It's how I come before God. I kneel at times whenever I feel like I ought to kneel. worship is less about what people think and more about how you interact with God. The important part of this is that you are true to how God has touched you, how He speaks to you. The second thing I want to look at, especially for our seniors, kind of goes beyond what we're reading in Scripture for today, throughout verse 13, or chapter 13. Saul has gone through his conversion on the road to Damascus. He is a believer in Christ, but he is still called Saul. Chapter 13 is where we see the evolution, if you will, of Saul into Paul. If you look at verse 2, it says, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul." Barnabas and Saul. Barnabas has believed here. As we move on down, we are introduced to Paul, or Saul, also called Paul. Okay, so now we see where he has become Paul. We see this kind of movement from the person he used to be to who he is now. A little ways down, we're introduced to Paul and his companions. So it's no longer Barnabas who has to lead, it's Paul. And then we finally become to Paul and Barnabas several times towards the end of the chapter. In a very short amount of time, Paul takes the lead, takes the flag for the Church of Christ, and moves it past where it was. So he takes it to places where the gospel had never been preached, where people did not have a base of faith. And he really takes the lead and essentially creates what we know as the church. Seniors, it's something that we don't really like to talk about, but we get old.
Sure.
We cannot relate to generations as they come up as well. Some people can. I think Paul has a fantastic ability to do it. Others can't. Each generation of the church carries that responsibility to move beyond where the church was, to take the church where it's at and lead it to where it's going. That's what Paul is doing here. He's taking the church where it's at. The sort of Jewish group that it was, and he's moving it to where it needs to be, this worldwide faith in Christ as the Messiah for all people, not just Jews, but Gentiles as well. It was a big to-do in the church in Jerusalem, whether or not the Word of God was for Greeks. It was, a big controversy until Peter stepped forward and said, no, the Word of God is for everyone. And Paul is the one who took that and said, okay, the Word of God is for everyone. I'm going to go tell them. I'm going to go tell everyone. He moved the church from where it was to where it needed to be. In much the same way, that is your task. That is your job as the leaders of the next generation of the church. The third thing I want to look at, I want you to notice here, is how the church handled sending out Barnabas and Saul. They did not do this on a whim. They weren't sitting around and the Holy Spirit didn't say, I want you to set apart Barnabas and Saul. And they said, okay, bye guys. You're gone. What are you still doing here? Pack your bags. Go. And instead, they sent them out. They prayed. They fasted. They did their due diligence, if you will, their preparation for the believers, or for Barnabas and Saul, before they sent them out. They covered them in prayer. In Sunday school this morning, we talked about, towards the end of Jesus' ministry, in the upper room, he gathers his disciples, the apostles, together, and he says, when I sent you out without a purse, without a cloak, you know, without any of that stuff, did you lack for anything? And they all said, no. He said, okay, this time when I send you out, bring everything. Everything you have, bring an extra cloak, bring extra sandals, bring money. If you have a sword, bring that. If you don't have a sword, sell your cloak, get a sword. Be prepared, because you're not coming back. This is where I send you out to spread my word. The first time the 12 apostles were sent out, or the 72, if you read Matthew or Luke, they were sent out and they came back. They brought back, they came back to Jesus, probably maybe a week or two, month at the most. Wasn't an extended period of time. Jesus only had 3 years to do what he needed to do. So they went out and they came back. It was not that long. At the end, though, Jesus says, be prepared for this journey, because this journey is not stopping. This journey, you may not see the end of it. You will continue this journey for the rest of your lives, so you must be prepared. Seniors, in the same way, as you leave high school, as you are confronted with the world, you need to be prepared for it. Jesus told his disciples, if you don't have a sword, sell your cloak, buy a sword. In Ephesians, Paul tells us that the sword of the Spirit is the Word of God, is Scripture. As part of graduation Sunday, we've got these Bibles. These Bibles are the swords with which we will send you out into the world. I have highlighters in the back. What I would like for the congregation to do is to come up and highlight your favorite verses in these, so that these seniors may have a ground, may have a base underneath them made of what you find speaks to you from Scripture. This is the sword that we are given. The church in Antioch fasted and they prayed about, you know, where Paul and Barnabas should go and how they should get there and how they should be supported. And in the end, they laid their hands on them and they sent them out. Laying on of hands, there's nothing supernatural about this. There's nothing, you know, spectacular, except that it conveys an acceptance, a dedication, if you will, of the task that you were given. Seniors, at this time, I'd like y'all to come up and have a seat here. Congregation, as part of sending our seniors out into the world, sending our seniors from the nice little bubble of high school into the big bad world of college and then beyond, I would like them to come up. We're going to lay hands on them and pray for them before we send them out. So at this time, they'll come forward. Those who want to, I'm going to. Don't come forward. We're going to lay hands on them. I'll lead a prayer and we send them out. Father, I come before you, God, I thank you, Father, for being and for Trevor, God, that I ask that as they leave here, that they leave constantly, God, that they would not fall by the wayside, Father, that they would continue on their faith and growing in you. God, I ask that you strengthen them and guide them to people who not only help them to grow, but God will meet them in that place. Jesus, we love them, and we know they love you. Thank you for being with them every day. Would you stand up right? over. A couple of final thoughts before we finish. My own encouragement and how I stay with the church. Whenever I got to Lamar, me and my friend Corbin Thompson, the summer before, went to Lamar and we started going through the Baptist student ministry, BSN. And we became involved in that. And through that, I grew more as a Christian, probably in the first couple of years of college, than I had in years of youth ministry, of children's ministry. I mean, I had been in church my whole life, but I connected with a group of believers that challenged me, that made me understand not only what I believed, but why I believed it. The conservative figures are that 75% of graduating seniors in the church leave the church and they don't come back until they're in their mid-30s and they have kids. That's 15 years of lost growth. Seniors, I urge you, find a group of people, find a group of believers that will challenge you, that will help you to grow, that will grow with you. I also urge you not to follow my example. I spent more time in BSN than I did in class. As a result, I have not gotten my diploma yet. You are there for an education. Remember that first and foremost. You are there for an education. But find a group of believers in a church, in a campus organization, wherever you can, find a group of believers that will strengthen and encourage you and help you grow. The church in Antioch did not send Barnabas and Saul out on their own. You know, they did not say, "All right, we're done with you. Bye." You know, instead, they supported them. They supported them with their prayers. They supported them with their love. As believers, we don't go anywhere on our own. Jesus sent out his 72 disciples 2 by 2. Paul and Barnabas were sent out together. While we may be here, perhaps on our own, Trevor's going to Texas A&M, right? While we may not be sending anyone with you, which I would love to come with, but not like this. While we may not be sending anyone with you, what we are sent with, wherever we go, is the Holy Spirit. We were promised a helper. We were promised a companion. And we have that in the Holy Spirit. As you leave, as you graduate, find somewhere where you can grow. Find somewhere where you can serve. Find somewhere where you can continue your journey in Christ. As Zach comes, I urge our seniors and I urge the congregation, keep our seniors in your prayers. Being a Christian is not an easy thing. It is getting progressively more and more difficult. As the world tells us, you're wrong. This is how we want to live. And the Bible tells us they're wrong. This is how they ought to live. Those two ideas are colliding more so now than ever before. Keep our seniors in your prayers. Because they will need it. Our folks in prayer, later in the week, for the last song, and we'll go over for our lunch. God, I thank you, Father, for the day you've given us again, Father, and for our seniors. God, I pray that as they go, Father, that not go alone, but they would be able to rely on you to put all their faith and on you, to lay everything at your feet, to give you, truly give you their lives. God, we love you. We thank you for loving us the way that only you can. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.